In this video, we're going to talk a bit about proteins, their functions, and their structure. The next type of macromolecules that we'll talk about are the proteins. Proteins are made up of amino acids, so they are the monomers for the proteins. There are 20 different amino acids. Now, even though there are 20 different amino acids, there are some parts that are very similar amongst the amino acids. They all have a central carbon atom, an amino group, a carboxyl group, and then finally, what makes them different from each other, the variable part of the amino acid, is known as the R group, or side chain. And it's this part that makes the 20 different amino acids different from each other. When we look at this base structure, again, there's that central carbon, an amino group, a carboxyl group, and then that R group, or side chain. Now, some of those R groups, or side chains, will be hydrophobic. They will be made up of nonpolar covalent bonds, and this will result in an amino acid, which is nonpolar, which does not want to mix with water, does not want to mix with other charged molecules, but instead will only want to associate with uncharged or neutral molecules. There are several amino acids that are either positively or negatively charged ions, or simply have polar covalent bonds, so these amino acids will be hydrophilic, meaning they will want to mix with water, they will want to mix with other charged molecules. These amino acids are connected to each other through a dehydration synthesis reaction, just as with the other macromolecules. Now, the name of the covalent bond that forms between two amino acids is known as a peptide bond. And so, a series of amino acids connected together in a long chain is known as a polypeptide. And that prefix poly meaning many, and in this case peptide referring to those peptide bonds. A protein is actually made of one or more polypeptide chains associated with each other. Peptide bonds are the covalent bonds that form between two amino acids. So this dehydration synthesis reaction is the same type of chemical reaction that is going to be used to assemble carbohydrates, to assemble nucleic acids, and then also here with proteins. A covalent bond is formed, a molecule of water is removed, but now we have a polymer, or two monomers linked together by covalent bonds. So what is it that proteins do? Almost all functions of a cell involve proteins in one form or another. Every chemical reaction in a cell is controlled by a type of protein called an enzyme. These enzymes are very important. Life would not be able to proceed as we know it without these enzymes. And so if that's all proteins were, if proteins were only enzymes, that would make them one of the most important types of molecules in the cell. Yet, they do even more things than just functioning as enzymes. Proteins provide the structural support of animal cells. Proteins perform any of the actions of a cell. If a cell is crawling, if a cell is dividing, if a cell is copying its genetic material, all of these actions which the cell performs are performed by proteins within the cell. You may wonder, how can proteins perform so many different jobs? Well, it is the shape of the protein that determines its functions. This is something we'll see time and time again in biology. The shape of a molecule or the shape of a structure determines its function. So with so many different jobs that proteins need to do, they need to come in a variety of different shapes. Each protein must have a unique shape, a shape that allows it to perform its job. And so making these proteins, making proteins that have the proper shape, we call this process protein synthesis. Protein synthesis is one of the most important jobs of a cell. The shape of a protein is essential for its function. So what determines that shape? Well, the most important aspect of that is the sequence of the amino acids. The order in which those amino acids are connected to each other will end up determining the shape of the protein. It will cause this chain of amino acids to fold in a particular manner. Another aspect that plays a role in determining the final shape of a protein is that of the cellular environment. Heat and acidity can end up impacting the shape of a protein. You've actually witnessed this if you've ever seen the difference between a raw egg and a cooked egg. When the proteins in that egg are raw, they are translucent, they are sticky, they are gelatinous. But as you cook those proteins found within the whites of the egg, something very interesting happens. The proteins that are present in the egg whites, they start to unwind, they unfold, they lose their shape, and by losing their shape or changing their shape, they change their physical structure, they change their properties. And that's why cooked egg whites will be solid and they will no longer be transparent, they'll be opaque, whereas raw egg whites will still be gelatinous and translucent. When we talk about proteins, there are four levels of protein structure that should be addressed. The first is known as the primary structure. The primary structure is simply the sequence or order of amino acids connected within the chain. And this is one of the most important things for determining the final shape of the protein. Once the primary structure is established, certain regions of that polypeptide chain will start wrapping around themselves or moving sinusoidally in a back and forth pattern. This is known as secondary structure. Secondary structure is a series of repeating patterns held together by hydrogen bonds. So looking at this diagram, the order in which the amino acids are connected to each other is known as the primary structure, and these repeated structures that we see along that polypeptide, those are the secondary structures. The third level of structure is known as the tertiary structure. And this is actually the final level of structure for a single polypeptide chain. It is held together by hydrophobic and hydrophilic interactions. If a protein is made up of only one polypeptide chain, the tertiary structure will be that final level of structures. But for larger, more complex proteins, which are made up of multiple polypeptide chains, then we'll also have a fourth level of structure, which is known as quaternary structure. Quaternary structure is when you have multiple polypeptide chains associated with each other. Quaternary structure is only present when a protein is made up of more than one polypeptide chain. So if we go back to that original diagram, we can see that tertiary structure is that final three-dimensional shape of a single polypeptide chain, whereas a larger complex protein, which is made up of multiple polypeptide chains or subunits, that level of structure, how those polypeptide chains interact with each other, That is known as quaternary structure. With that, we're to the end of our discussion of proteins. The final macromolecule we will discuss are lipids.